Lord, I believe.
And Jesus would have had his meeting, and nothing would have happened. The man wouldn't have been healed. These fellows never did say, I believe, Lord, I believe. But they acted. They tore the roof up. They got their man in there, and he got healed. Hallelujah. That's faith with action.
Amen.
Now, the Bible says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And the man was healed. In Jamaica, three women did the same thing. I've always said, if we'll read the Bible and come to Christ like they came in the Bible, we'll have the blessings that they received in the Bible. These three Jamaican women proved that. They had a friend who had a total paralytic stroke. Her eyes were rolled back. Her tongue hanged to one side. 4 days she had not swallowed. She was dying. She was completely paralyzed. These three women did what those four men did in the Bible. They picked her up, put her on a wheelbarrow, and brought her to the meeting, laid her down before the platform, and that night, that woman got up and walked and went home well.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. They put actions with their faith. They didn't just talk about it, they acted it. Praise the Lord. You must understand, in Bible days, God spoke to his holy prophets, and they spoke God's word. And wherever they spoke God's word, the people acted on the word of God, spoken by the prophets and by the men of God. Then, God moved on holy men of old, and they wrote. And they wrote down as God spoke to them. So we have the written word of God, not the spoken word of God. They didn't have the written word of God. They had the spoken voice of God. God spoke. They heard his voice. The prophet told them what to do. They acted on the word, and a miracle took place because God confirmed the word of his prophets. The Bible says that. But now today, we don't operate that way. God don't speak through a prophet and a prophet tell us. Don't get worried here. I'm not talking doctrine now. Some of you may believe in prophets, all that. That's good. What I'm talking about in general, you don't go through and hear a voice from heaven to a man and he tells the people and then everybody goes with that. Today, we have the written word of God, the Bible. This is what we go by today. A lot of folks chase a lot of these visions, a lot of these prophecies, and they go off in deep water and get fanatical and all that nonsense, and I have no patience with it at all. The Word of God is good enough for me. I'll act on the Word of God, and you'll do wise to do the same. All right? So today, we have the Word of God written that we can read and act upon. Now, the written word of God is just as real as the spoken word of God was back there before they had the written word. God will back up his written word the same tonight as he backed up his spoken word in the days of the prophets. You believe that? Just the same. So back there, they acted on the word of God as it was spoken to them, and it worked. It came to pass. Every time. Today, we act upon the written word of God, and it works. It comes to pass every time, just the same. It never fails. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
You see, the Bible says, God speaks, I watch over my words to perform them. Tonight, when I cite to you the promises of God, and you act upon them, God from heaven is looking down, watching that word, and is going to confirm it and perform it when you act upon it. Last night, when that Muslim boy heard the gospel, he heard how that Jesus came and bore our sicknesses and bore our sins and took them away. That precious young boy believe that. But friends, while I was preaching, he did more than just believe it. He acted upon it. He took off that big brace all the way to his hip. He took off that terrible clumsy shoe that was built up on a steel platform 5 inches tall. Why did he take them off? Because he believed that the devil couldn't hold him anymore, that Jesus had borne this disease for him, and that by his suffering he was healed. And he did what I told him to do. He acted upon that. I don't know when it happened or how, but that leg that was shorter became as long as the other and filled out, and it's perfect. Both legs, beautiful and whole and perfect. This is a miracle. He put action to his faith.
Amen.
He could have kept all this apparatus on and stood there with one leg short and the other and said, I believe. Thank you for the gospel. I believe it. He only believed it when he took them things off and said, this is true. I'm getting out of my prison. Let me go.
Amen.
He believed it, and God confirmed it. The only kind of faith that God honors is the acting faith. When you act, that's what proves what you believe. The Bible says, there hath not failed one word of all of his good promises which he hath promised. God cannot fail. God cannot lie. The Bible says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away.
Amen.
God says, my word shall not return to me void. It will accomplish that for which I have sent it. When the person hears the promise, believes it with his whole heart, confesses it with his mouth, and steps out to act upon it with his action, then the Holy Ghost from God comes on that person and makes it good and brings it to pass. Hallelujah. This is the way God works. That's why when Jesus, after he died for us and paid the price for our sins and for our diseases, died under the load, then raised from the dead, then called his disciples together and said, now, go preach to every creature. Lo, I am with you alway. Hallelujah. The Bible says, they went forth and preached everywhere. But it says something else. The Lord, working with them, confirming the word with signs following. And so the young lad Harold is a sign confirmed by the Lord that you might believe the gospel. Hallelujah. The Lord confirmed the word. And so tonight he'll do the same. He'll do it again tonight. Now, Peter went forth after Jesus had told them to go preach everywhere. He went to Jerusalem. And this beggar was there by the side of the road. And Peter did what Jesus said do. He took him by the hand and said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. He picked him up. Immediately, his feet and ankle bones received strength, and he began to leap and jump and walk and entered with them into the temple. Peter didn't do that. Jesus did that. Peter was a preacher just like me. He prayed, but Jesus did the miracle. They acted their faith. Peter took him by the hand, and the lame man put his energy to work. In the Old Testament, God spoke, they acted on it, and it came to pass. Let me give you an example. When the children of Israel were in Egypt, God sent Moses to lead them out. They came to the Red Sea. They couldn't cross. God spoke to Moses and said, stretch out your rod and see the salvation of God. Moses did it. And he heard that. He could have said, oh my, we better have a prayer meeting. They could have prayed and prayed. And I don't suppose the Red Sea ever would have come open. Now, Moses could have said, look here, Lord, I can stretch out that rod, but that ain't going to do no good. You've got to open them waters. But he didn't say that. Just like you could say, Lord, I can try to get up and walk, but it won't do no good because I'm crippled. Don't do that. That's not faith. Moses didn't say that. When God said, stretch out your rod, he must have said to himself, well, I don't know what good this will do, but I know if God says it, I'm going to do it. He stretches out his rod, hallelujah, and holds it there. And as he does, God sends the great wind and the waters open, and the children of Israel are saved. Praise the name of the Lord. Why, look at Joshua. When they came to the walls of Jericho, this wicked city, how can they take this city? What can they do? God speaks. March around the walls. Shout and blow your trumpets. Didn't that look silly? Joshua could have said, Lord, that don't make sense. We can't work psychology on these folks. It ain't going to scare them. If we walk around it till we wear the soles of our shoes off, it's not going to make them walls come down. We'll walk around it, but what good will it do? Lord, oh Lord, he could have said to all of his people, let's pray for God to tear the walls down. It wouldn't have done any good. God said, march around the walls 7 times. And Joshua was a man of faith. He knew to believe God, and he put his believing into action. What did he do? When God said march, he said, come on, fellows, let's march. And around the walls they went. Hallelujah. 1 time, 2 times, 3 times. And I can see those wicked Canaanites looking over the wall saying, look at them crazy things down there. Do they think they can scare us? They weren't trying to scare them. They were believing God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
They marched around the walls 7 times, and Joshua said, now shout. Blow your trumpets and shout. They blew their trumpets and shouted. Hallelujah. And when they did, the walls fell down flat, and they took the city. They put their believing into action. That's the secret of dynamic faith. That's the secret of your faith tonight. Put your believing into action. Do what God says. Act upon His word. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Look at Elisha. When the poor widow woman didn't have the money to pay her bills, she came and said, what can I do? He said, have you got any oil? Yes, just a little bit. Well, he said, then you go borrow a bunch of vessels and get them in there and act your faith. And what happens? She got him in there. The prophet said, now, take your little pitcher ball and pour it out. She did. Looked silly, didn't it? But she acted her faith. And when she poured out all that she had, God poured in some new. And God kept pouring, kept pouring, kept pouring, till every vessel was full. That's what I'm talking about. Acting on the spoken word of God through the prophet. See, God spoke through the prophet. That was the spoken word. They acted on it, and God did miracles. One day, the people had no water for all their cattle and all their horses, and they were going to die in the desert. They prayed and went to the prophet. What can we do? The prophet spoke the word of God. Make this valley full of ditches. Didn't that look silly? To dig a bunch of ditches out in a hot desert when there was no rain, there was no water. God said, dig your ditches. They looked stupid, but they were acting on the word of God spoken by the prophet. When they acted and dug the ditches, God did a miracle. Hallelujah. He filled the ditches with water, and everybody had plenty water. Do you see what I mean? That little woman, she poured out what little oil she had. God gave more, and a miracle was wrought. She filled all the vessels. She sold it all. She had plenty of money. She paid her debts, and her boys didn't have to be taken from her. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, you, some of you have got just a little strength, just a little physical strength in your vessel. Tonight, pour it out. Act upon the word of God. Throw down your crutches. Step out by faith in the name of Jesus and do all you can. And as you do that much, God will pour in fresh strength, fresh oil, and you will walk and be well and whole. Hallelujah. Because when we put action with our faith, that's living faith. This is so simple. You take, for example, a little girl in Cuba that had a disease in her bones. The ball of the hip was removed. So there was nothing to connect her leg with the socket. Well, that left it limp and useless. So, naturally, they put her on crutches, and so she walked that way, dangling this leg. She stood out on the field and heard the gospel, as I'm preaching tonight. She believed it. And when I prayed for all the people, I didn't even know she was there. But she prayed. It was all through. Then I commanded the people, do what you couldn't do before. In the name of Jesus, put action to your faith. That little girl, about 12 years old, tears in her eyes, looked at her mother and her daddy, took her crutches, handed them to them. And she stepped out. The minute she stepped out, God created bone. And she was well.
Praise.
That girl came up the steps, walking as perfect as I can walk tonight, perfectly healed. That was a miracle that staggered Eastern Cuba. God created the bone, and the girl was perfect. That same night, a little girl with braces on both legs from polio up to her knees, unbuckled them, took them off, and stood to her feet to walk in Jesus' name. At first it wasn't perfect, then as she walked, it became as perfect as I am. When she came to the platform, you could not tell that she had ever had polio. As perfect as that boy last night. When we act on God's promise, God watches His word and fulfills His promise. You can do that tonight. That's happened all over the world. It can happen to you tonight. I was preaching in Lucknow, India. A lovely looking old man with a long, beautiful white beard stood over there looking through the banister, just watching me intent on his old crutches. Crippled, couldn't walk. I saw him. I knew that God was dealing with the old man's soul. And when I looked over and I stopped in my sermon and I said, old man, you've never heard this gospel before, have you? He said, no. I said, tonight when I get through preaching about Jesus, you accept him. Then when we pray, you believe and he'll heal you. And when you believe, even before you feel healing, put those crutches down and walk and you're going to be healed. Then I went on preaching and I forgot about him. There was so many there, it slipped my mind. I forgot that I had even said anything to him. And so we preached. And then we prayed for their souls to be saved. And thousands of those precious Hindu people repeated the prayer for salvation and received Jesus for the first time into their hearts and lives. It was such a precious meeting. Then we prayed for their sick and asked the Lord to come and heal them like He had promised to do if they would only believe on Him. And our Lord in compassion came down on that multitude and they began to get healed. And then I told the people, I commanded them, if you could not do something before, now in the name of Jesus, get up and do it. If you believe that you're healed, act like you believe it. Do what you couldn't do in your own strength. Do it depending in the strength of God. Do it now. About that time, somebody bounded across behind me, and I thought, what's going on? And I turned around. That was the old Hindu man with his crutches in the air. He was jumping and prancing like that fellow last night that first came up here. I tell you, that old man was so happy. Tears was running down, dripping from his old white beard. He was healed. He found Jesus. It was a miracle. But he didn't have dead faith. Like a lot of folks have, he had living faith.
Amen.
Faith with action that corresponded. You can have that kind of faith tonight. Praise the Lord. Do you believe it?
Amen.
You really believe it?
Amen.
You see, Jesus said, preach the gospel in all the world. He that believeth shall be saved.
Amen.
He's watching for the opportunity to fulfill his promise because he watches over his words to perform them. Just let me remind you of this, my friends. God created man and woman strong and well, not sick. But then he told them not to sin or they would die. But they did sin. And when they sinned, they were driven out from God's presence. A slave of Satan. And from that day, they were separated from God. Bound by sin, by disease, by pain, by heartache, by suffering. These are all the evils of Satan. But God in his love found a way to save us. He sent his son Jesus, who had no sin, to die for us. And when he died for us, he bore our sins, he bore our sicknesses, he bore our pains, he bore our sufferings, and died under the load. The wages of sin is death. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent Jesus to die in your place. And the Bible says, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. And with his stripes, we are healed. If you believe Jesus took your diseases and carried your pains, then the question, how could you have them? All right? Then you begin to think, aha, it's the devil that put them on me. Jesus took them for me, but now the devil's trying to keep them on me. He's a liar. He's a murderer. He's trying to kill me. Well, if I'm going to serve the devil, then I can't help myself. But if I'm going to serve the Lord, then I'm not going to have this anymore. Because Jesus took my disease, bore my sickness, bore my sin. So, since he took it from me, I believe it. I'm going to act like it. I'm going to get up and be whole. That's faith in action. Look at the blind man. Jesus clay on his eyes and said, now go wash in the pool of Siloam and you'll receive sight. That man didn't say, oh no, Lord, I'm blind, I can't go. He went and washed, and what he did, he acted on the word of Jesus. He came back seeing. Praise the name of the Lord. Look at the man that came to Jesus and said, Jesus, my little boy is about to die with fever. Jesus said, go home, your boy is living. He's healed. The man believed what Jesus said and went home, and the boy was healed. Hallelujah, look at that. Praise the Lord. That's faith in action. Look at the cripple. They carried him to Jesus. Jesus said, rise, take up your bed, and walk. What did he do? He didn't lay there and say, no, Lord, I'm crippled. You don't understand. I can't walk. He rose. He took up his bed. He walked. He was made whole. Praise the name of the Lord. The man with the crippled hand came to Jesus. What did Jesus do? Hear me. He said, stretch out thine hand. What did the man do? Say, no, Lord, it's withered. You don't understand. He stretched it and stretched it. What did he do? And trembled. And it opened up. He acted on the word of Jesus, and he was made whole. I say to you people tonight, I say to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I announce to you, I tell you tonight, that Jesus Christ went to the cross, went to the whipping post, and bled and died and bore your diseases and suffered your pains and carried your guilt and your sin and your disease away. Jesus did it. I say to you tonight, when he bore your sin, you were forgiven. Your sins were carried away. You don't have to be punished for your sins. Jesus was punished in your place. All you have to do is tonight believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be forgiven and be saved. And in the same way, I say to you, Jesus went to the whipping post and bore your diseases, took your pains, suffered your diseases, and by his stripes you were healed. That is the Bible. I say to you, your diseases are of the devil. Jesus carried them for you, and he doesn't want you to carry them any longer. But you didn't know that, and so the devil kept them on you. But I have come tonight, and I have announced to you what the gospel says, that he bore your disease. He carried your sickness. He bore your pain. I say to you, if you will accept Jesus with your hurt, the devil cannot keep that disease on you any longer. He will have to leave you free. You're not his prisoner any longer. And so tonight, you can step out of your prison house of disease when you accept Jesus, and you can take your healing and thank him for it. And when you do that and act upon his word, God will send his spirit over you, and you will be healed and flourish in new strength and new health. Hallelujah. I want to lead you in talking to God so that you can confess to God openly that you believe on him, that you believe what you've heard, that you accept it, that you're going to live by it. When you repeat this after me, repeat it from your heart, men and women, and God is looking down from heaven to perform it in your life. He's working with me tonight, confirming the word with signs and miracles following. So when we pray, when we talk to God, if you pray it from your heart, not one sin will be left in your life. You'll be clean, you'll be pure, you'll be righteous before God. The blood of Jesus will cleanse you. And in the same way, your sickness will go from you. You can begin to do what you couldn't do before. You can begin to use your arms. You can begin to check your ears. You can begin to use your blind eyes. You can begin to use your crippled backs and your legs because you've accepted Jesus. All right. I want you to put your hand wherever you suffer, wherever you want the Lord to lay his hand, and repeat this prayer out loud after me from the very bottom of your heart. Everyone together. If you're deaf, stuff up your deaf ear. If you're blind, cover your blind eyes. If you've got a little sick child, put your hand on its head or hold it in your arms. If you've got any inside disease, just put your hand on your heart, because we're going to pray from our heart. If you've got blindness or tumor or cancer, my friends, I don't care what it is, it will disappear from you the very moment that you receive Jesus and really believe in him. All right, close your eyes, draw nigh to God, be very reverent, and repeat this after me, everyone. Say, oh God in heaven, I believe what I have heard. You went to the cross for me. You bore my sins. I'm ashamed, Lord, of my many sins. But I thank you, Lord, because you loved me, even when I sinned. And now tonight, I believe what I have heard with all of my heart. I believe that you took my sins and your blood cleansed me. And right now, I'm a child of God. My sins are gone. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. And I promise I will always follow you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for forgiving me. Now, Lord, I ask you to heal me just like you've saved me. I believe what I have heard. You went to the whipping post for me. You bore my sicknesses. You suffered my pains and my diseases. Thank you, Lord. I don't have to be sick anymore. Thank you, Jesus. It's the devil that's done it to me. I rebuke the devil. I resist you, Satan. You've tried to put disease on me. You're not my master anymore. In Jesus' name, you've got to go. Because Jesus bore my sickness for me. And by his stripes I was healed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm healed now. I accept my healing. I accept my deliverance. In Jesus' name, it is done to me right now. Hallelujah. And I'm happy. I'm happy. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, my friends, put up your hands together to God. Keep your eyes closed. Keep lost with God. Thank him in your own words. Thank him now. Hallelujah. Now, don't wait any longer, but do what you could not do before you pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, do it now. If you couldn't hear, check your ears and hear now. If you couldn't see, open your eyes and look at your hands. Look at the lights now. Amen. If you couldn't walk, put your canes or your sticks up in the air and turn around and walk without them. Act your faith in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. If you couldn't breathe, breathe deep now. If you have pains or cancer or tumor, see where they're at now. Thank him out loud. Praise him and see where they've gone. If you couldn't bend, bend. Do what you couldn't do. Praise the Lord. If you had a chair, get up off of it and walk. If you were on a bed, get up and walk. Thank God, thank God.
Que o poder do Espírito Santo pode mover sobre os nossos corpos
and upon our spirits,
e sobre os nossos espíritos
and can do anything.
E você pode fazer qualquer coisa.
If we hear the gospel,
se nós ouvimos o Evangelho
and believe the gospel,
e cremos no Evangelho,
if we hear of Jesus,
se nós ouvimos a respeito de Jesus
and believe in Jesus,
e cremos em Jesus,
all things are possible to the one that believes.
Todas as coisas são possíveis àquele que crê.
Jesus amazes me.
Jesus me surpreende.
He was born by a miracle. He was conceived by a miracle.
Ele foi concebido por milagre.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I remember the day that I heard the gospel.
Eu me lembro do dia em que eu ouvi o evangelho.
And I was conceived.
E eu fui concebido.
By the word of God.
Pela palavra de Deus.
The gospel came into me.
O evangelho entrou em mim.
I believed it.
Eu creio nela.
I think the same thing happened to me.
E eu creio que a mesma coisa aconteceu comigo.
His spirit came into me.
O seu espírito veio no meu interior.
I believed.
Eu creio.
And I was born again.
E eu nasci de novo.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And today I'm a believer.
E hoje eu sou que crê.
Praise God.
Louvado seja Deus.
Everything I see about Jesus inspires me.
Tudo que eu vejo a respeito de Jesus me inspira.
The Bible says, it talks about all that he began to do and teach.
A Bíblia nos fala sobre tudo que ele começou a dizer e a fazer.
He wants us to continue it.
Ele quer que nós venhamos a dar continuidade.
But it says what he began.
Mas diz aquilo que ele deu início.
To do and to teach.
A fazer e a ensinar.
Until the day he was taken up.
Até o dia que ele foi levado.
I want to urge you.
Eu quero trazer algo ao seu interior.
Reread the story of his life and ministry.
Uma urgência para que você leia novamente a sua história e o seu ministério.
Analyze how many things happened.
Analise quantas coisas aconteceram.
How many things he did that inspire you.
Quantas coisas ele fez que te inspiram.
How many words he spoke that inspire you.
Quantas palavras que ele falou que te inspiram.
How many miracles he performed that inspire you.
Quantos milagres que ele fez que te inspiram.
How many times he showed compassion on needy people. Let it inspire.
Quantas vezes ele mostrou paixão por aquelas pessoas necessitadas? Permita que isso te inspire.
Why do we want to be inspired?
Por que nós queremos ser inspirados?
Because we are his interpreters.
Porque nós somos intérpretes dele.
We are his associates.
Nós somos os associados dele.
We are his friends.
Nós somos os seus amigos.
We are his family.
Nós somos a sua família.
We are his followers.
Nós somos os seus seguidores.
We are believers.
Nós somos crentes.
And whatever he did,
e aquilo que ele fez,
he says we can do.
Ele diz que nós podemos fazer.
So what he did inspires me.
Então aquilo que ele fez me inspira.
And shows me how wonderful my life can be as his messenger.
E me mostra o quanto a minha vida pode ser maravilhosa como seu mensageiro.
I've spent my life making people happy.
Eu tenho gasto a minha vida fazendo com que pessoas sejam alegres.
Getting them to follow Jesus.
Levando-as a seguir Jesus.
Think about Jesus.
Pensem sobre Jesus.
He came.
Ele veio.
And he was led of the Spirit into the wilderness.
E ele foi levado pelo Espírito até o deserto.
To be tempted of Satan.
Para ser tentado por Satanás.
Now why did he need to be tempted of Satan?
Agora por que ele precisava ser tentado por Satanás?
The same Satan that came to Adam and Eve in the garden came to Jesus in the wilderness.
O mesmo Satanás que veio até Adão e Eva lá no jardim, veio até Jesus no deserto.
Satan came to Adam and Eve and tempted them.
Satanás veio até Adão e Eva e os tentou.
And God told them, "Don't eat of that tree."
E Deus disse a eles, não comam desta árvore.
Or you'll die.
Ou morrereis.
Satan came and contradicted what God said.
Satanás veio contradizer aquilo que Deus havia dito.
Said, "Go ahead and eat it."
E ele diz, pode comer.
It'll make you smart.
Vai fazer de você um espertalhão.
And you won't die.
E você não morrerá.
See, he contradicted what God said.
Ele trouxe uma contradição àquilo que Deus havia
dito. Adam and Eve did not believe what God said.
Adão e Eva não creram naquilo que Deus havia dito.
They did believe what the devil said.
Eles acreditaram naquilo que o diabo disse.
Have you ever been like that?
Vocês já estiveram nessa posição?
If the devil lies to you,
se o diabo mente a você,
don't believe him.
Não creia nele.
Now, that made a separation between people and God.
Agora isso fez uma separação entre as pessoas e Deus.
And all down through the years we were separated from God.
E por todos esses anos nós fomos separados de Deus.
And there was no way that our sins could be paid for.
E não havia como os nossos pecados receberem pagamento por eles.
So God sent Jesus to pay for us.
Então Deus enviou Jesus para pagar o preço por nós.
This is the power of the gospel that I'm saying.
Esse é o poder do evangelho que eu estou dizendo.
Paul said the gospel is the power of God to salvation.
Paulo diz que o evangelho é o poder de Deus para a salvação.
I believe that.
Eu creio nisso.
The gospel is good news.
O evangelho é boas novas.
What good news?
Quais são as boas novas?
Good news to the sinner.
Boas novas ao pecador.
Jesus bore your sin.
Jesus carregou sobre si o seu pecado.
Why?
Por quê?
So that you don't have to bear your sin.
Para que você não precise carregar o seu pecado.
So what's the result?
Então qual é o resultado?
You are saved.
Você é salvo.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's the gospel.
Este é o evangelho.
Good news to the sick person.
Boas novas à pessoa enferma.
What good news?
Quais boas novas?
Jesus bore your sickness.
Jesus carregou sobre si as suas enfermidades.
Why?
Por quê?
So that you don't have to.
Para que você não tenha que fazê-lo.
So what's the result?
Então qual é o resultado?
You are healed.
Você é curado.
When that dawns on us.
Quando isso
é esclarecido a nós. Then the gospel is fulfilled in us.
Então o evangelho é preenchido, cumprido em nós.
So Jesus came.
Então Jesus veio.
He lived among us.
Ele viveu em meio a nós.
And he showed us how we can be with God in us.
E ele nos mostrou como nós podemos ser com Deus em nós.
When at the end of his life,
quando no final de sua vida,
then he became the Lamb of God to die for us.
Então ele se tornou o Cordeiro de Deus para morrer por nós.
In order for him to take our place,
para que ele pudesse tomar o nosso lugar,
he had to be tested every way possible.
Ele precisava ser testado de todas as maneiras possíveis.
So he was tested by the same devil that came to Adam and Eve.
E então ele foi testado pelo mesmo diabo que veio até Adão e Eva.
But he was different than Adam and Eve.
Mas ele era diferente de Adão e Eva.
In the fourth chapter of Matthew.
No capítulo 4 do livro de Mateus.
I'm saying this inspires me.
Agora quero dizer porque isso me inspira.
Jesus is my inspiration.
Jesus é a minha inspiração.
You're going to meet the devil now and then.
Você vai se encontrar com o diabo periodicamente.
What are you going to do? You're going to be afraid of him?
O que você vai fazer? Você vai estar amedrontado por ele?
You're going to run from him?
Você vai correr dele?
You're going to believe his lies?
Você vai crer nas mentiras dele?
No.
Não.
Jesus, our Lord, showed us how to whip the devil.
Jesus, o nosso Senhor, nos mostrou como vencer o diabo.
The tempter said, "You're hungry. Turn those stones into bread."
O tentador disse, "Você está com fome? Transforme essas pedras em pão."
Jesus said, "No, you've forgotten that the word of God says that I don't live by bread alone."
E ele diz, "Não, você se esqueceu que a palavra de Deus diz que eu não vivo tão somente do pão."
He didn't do what the devil suggested.
Ele não fez aquilo que estava sendo sugerido pelo diabo.
He comes back to him again.
E ele volta a ele novamente.
And he sits him on the pinnacle of the city.
E ele senta a ele no pináculo do templo.
And he says, "Cast yourself down. It won't hurt you."
E ele diz, "Pode se jogar, você não vai machucar."
You're powerful. You're full of the Holy Ghost. Go on, do it. It won't hurt you.
Você é poderoso, você está cheio do Espírito Santo. Pode ir, vai à frente, você não vai se machucar.
Jesus said, "Wait a minute."
E Jesus disse, espera só um minutinho.
You're wrong again.
Você está errado novamente.
You've forgotten what the Bible says.
Você se esqueceu daquilo que a Bíblia diz.
The word of God says, I'm not to tempt God.
A palavra de Deus diz que eu não devo tentar a Deus.
He didn't believe the devil.
Ele não acreditou no
Satan
diabo.
Came again.
E Satanás veio novamente.
He tried again and showed him all the kingdoms of the world. Said, I'll give you all of it if you'll worship me.
E ele tentou novamente e mostrou todos os reinos do mundo. Ele diz, eu vou entregar tudo isso a você se você me adorar.
Jesus said, you're wrong again.
E Jesus diz, você está errado novamente.
The scriptures say that you shall worship only God.
A escritura nos diz, ao Senhor teu Deus tão somente adorarás.
What's my point?
Qual é o meu ponto?
My point is, three times Satan came to Jesus.
O meu ponto é que por três vezes Satanás veio a Jesus.
Three times he tempted him.
Por três vezes ele o tentou.
Three times Jesus quoted the scripture to him.
Por três vezes Jesus citou as escrituras a ele.
And that's all the devil could take.
E é somente isso que o diabo pôde aguentar e tolerar.
That proves to me he's not a very big devil.
E isso prova a mim que ele não é um diabo tão grande assim.
Three scriptures and he can't take more.
Três escrituras e ele já não aguenta mais.
The Bible says then the devil left him.
Então a Bíblia nos diz que o diabo o deixou.
Angels came and ministered to him.
E anjos vieram e ministraram a ele.
Inspires me.
E isso me inspira.
I say, Mr. Devil,
e eu digo, Senhor Diabo,
come on if you want to.
Pode vir se você quiser.
I have something.
Eu tenho algo
that I'll quote to you.
Que eu vou citar a você.
You're a liar.
Você é um mentiroso.
I know the truth.
E eu conheço a verdade.
You're in trouble when I come to town.
E você está com problemas quando eu chego na cidade.
I'm inspired.
Eu sou inspirado.
I'm the boss.
Eu sou o patrão.
Jesus is in me.
Jesus está em mim.
I'm reconciled to God.
Eu estou reconciliado a
the
Deus.
Devil's the enemy.
E o diabo é o inimigo.
He's a destroyer.
Ele é um destruidor.
He's a killer.
Ele é um matador.
He's a liar.
Ele é um mentiroso.
When he comes to me,
e quando ele vem até a mim,
I've got the Bible to show him.
Eu tenho a Bíblia para mostrar
That's
a ele.
Why he leaves me alone.
E é por isso que ele me deixa em paz. Quando eu chego por uma porta na cidade, eu creio que ele sai por outra.
Poor devil.
Coitado do diabo.
Yeah, I believe that.
Sim, eu creio nisso.
Aleluia.
Aleluia.
I've got to tell you what happened to my daughter.
Eu preciso contar a vocês aqui o que aconteceu com minha filha.
She's a preacher.
Ela é uma pregadora.
She's a better preacher than me.
Ela é uma melhor pregadora do que eu.
You need to have her come to Brazil.
Vocês precisam tê-la aqui no Brasil.
The devil will say, please don't bring LaDonna Osborne.
E o diabo está dizendo, por favor, não traga ela.
You get her here.
Vocês podem trazê-la.
And there was a demon-possessed woman in our church.
Havia uma mulher que estava possessa por demônio na nossa igreja.
And that woman was a pain in the neck.
E aquela mulher realmente estava dando muito trabalho.
She was disturbing.
Ela estava atrapalhando.
She was a problem.
Ela era um problema.
Yeah, she was one of these so-called Christians.
Ela era uma dessas conhecidas como cristãs.
That thought she had a devil.
Que achava que ela tinha um demônio.
Now, I don't want to change your doctrine, but I don't believe in that.
Eu não quero mudar a sua doutrina, mas eu não acredito
nisso.
I don't
believe Jesus and the devil lives together.
Eu não acredito que Jesus e o diabo vivem juntos.
If you want to believe that, okay, go ahead.
Se você quer acreditar, tudo bem, não tem problema.
I know that's a popular doctrine now.
Eu sei que é uma doutrina popular no momento.
I don't believe in it.
Mas eu não creio nela.
I don't believe in light and darkness mixing.
Eu não acredito que a luz e as trevas podem se misturar.
I don't believe in devils and Jesus mixing.
Eu não acredito em Jesus e demônios se misturando.
My body is the temple of the Holy Ghost.
O meu corpo é o templo do Espírito Santo.
There's no room for devils.
Não tem lugar algum aqui para demônios.
I know we've got a bunch of theories that it's old hangovers from the old life. That's all right if you believe that.
Eu sei que nós temos uma série de ensinamentos que são coisas que vieram da nossa vida passada, anterior, de gerações.
Don't talk to me about that.
Não precisa conversar comigo a respeito disso.
When you get saved,
quando você é salvo,
I believe you're saved.
Eu creio que você é salvo.
When Jesus comes,
quando Jesus vier,
I believe the devil leaves.
Quando Jesus vem, eu acredito que o diabo vai.
I'm a believer in Jesus, not devils.
Eu sou que acredita em Jesus e não nos demônios.
I hate the devil.
Eu odeio o diabo.
I don't believe in devils for Christians.
E eu não acredito em demônios para cristãos.
Never.
Nunca.
I believe in Jesus for Christians.
Eu acredito em Jesus para os cristãos.
Devils for non-Christians.
E os demônios para os não cristãos.
When we come to Jesus.
E quando nós chegamos a Jesus.
And it's Jesus.
Então é Jesus o tempo todo.
Well, this woman was one of those that had been to one of these churches that believes you can have Jesus and devils at the same time.
E essa mulher foi uma que veio à igreja e ela acreditava que você podia ter Jesus e os demônios ao mesmo tempo.
And so the devil will accommodate people like that.
E o diabo vai acomodar pessoas que creem assim.
He'll help you to have a fit.
Ele vai ajudar vocês a terem um espetáculo.
Or do something crazy.
Ou fazer uma coisa louca.
Don't cooperate with him.
Não coopere com ele.
Let Jesus be the king of your life.
Deixe Jesus ser o rei da sua vida.
You understand?
Vocês estão entendendo?
So LaDonna got tired of this woman.
Então LaDonna, ela ficou cansada dessa mulher.
So she took her in her office.
Então ela
religion is a creed, a ritual, a dogma. Christianity, biblical Christianity, is life. You believe that? I'll just share this little poem. Here's a little poem that I wrote way back. I probably read this to you before. Christ is alive. He now reigns in our hearts. He called us. He filled us. He set us apart. the truth. And his truth and his grace were the seeds of our start. His love energizes the life we impart. You believe that? Do you impart life? I do. We touch people and we share life with people. Most exciting thing in the world, to feel loved by people and to love people. It's wonderful. He sent us to give the good news to the poor. You ought to get this off the tape and copy it down. He sent us to give the good news to the poor, to tell all the captives they're prisoners no more. That's our message. To announce to the blind that their sight is restored, to lift the downtrodden, they're free evermore. Isn't that an uplifting message? Religion don't give you that. Religion, whether, you know, Christians have made a religion out of Christianity. But Christianity, biblical Christianity, is not a religion. It's a life. You say, I believe that. Yeah, yeah. As the Father, here's our commission. As the Father sent Jesus to show forth his will, now Jesus sends us to reveal him, until everyone knows that of his own free will, Christ died to redeem them, to heal every ill. Say hallelujah. Yeah. So now that God's kingdom in us is the key, our reason on earth is to let Jesus be the same in our flesh. He lives to set free whoever believes the good news. Let it be. Hallelujah. 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 A great distinguished gentleman in Ghana about 70, we passed through there and had a big meeting. And this distinguished gentleman said, what a wonder your crusade at Independence Square by the Arch of Triumph. New peace and renewed faith came to the most troubled of our people. And then he said, you know, I like for people to brag on me, so I'm reading this to you. See, okay? Dr. Osborne, your work is noble and invaluable as you point people to Jesus. You have made the Bible new in Ghana. Our nation is asking, is this the same Jesus that we have been worshiping? The Jesus you proclaim is not religious, but is biblical. I like that. I like that. Is what you have biblical or religious? Hallelujah. I'm very blessed. I'm very thankful for all that God is doing. I've just come from Karaganda. I have to think to even say the name. Karaganda, Kazakhstan. I didn't know that Kazakhstan was like Siberia during the communism period. They sent people to Siberia for slave labor, or Kazakhstan. I didn't know that. And the people are really beautiful, really wonderful. And it was such a joy to lift them in Christ and show them who they are. We spent 10 days teaching, an hour and a half every day. And it really was wonderful. We brought in there tons of our books and gave everybody that came four of our big books. real investment, help people. We didn't ask them for anything, but we wanted to give to them. Love pays the price. You believe that? And you people are like that. You give, you share. It's wonderful. Before that, we came from Togo and Ghana. Togo was phenomenal. The crowds were enormous, and so many of the people were healed while we preached that I never got to pray for the sick a single night. Think of that. While I was preaching, they believed it, they acted on it. Pretty soon, here would come up a wheelchair or a pair of crutches. You ought to see the pictures that photographers grabbed. They gave me a whole bunch of them before I left on the computer. Amazing at the wonders. Every picture, different parts of the crowd, there were a wheelchair or crutches or canes raising up. This is beautiful. This is the gospel we preach. This is what Jesus preached. He hasn't changed. Don't be afraid of it. Your faith makes it possible. Only believe. All things are possible. You believe that? We had such a wonderful time. Before that, we've just recently come from Japan. Marvelous. Marvelous. Japan. The Japanese are so entrepreneurial and they're terrific people. And the meeting was overwhelming. We were there 40 years ago in Kyoto, and we used a big field almost under the shadow of the biggest Shintoist temples in Japan. And almost under the shadow of those temples, 44 deaf mutes were healed during that crusade. Isn't that phenomenal? Blind people cut casts off of the body. Just, you know, people that aren't used to this. You folks that have just come the first time, I don't know where you came from. But people that are usually just plugged into religion, when they hear those things, they think, wait a minute, this guy is crazy. He don't know what he's talking about. But you see, we who see it, we wonder, we marvel that you don't understand it and believe it. Because it happened all through the Bible. Christ hasn't changed. And if we believe, it's the same today. Hallelujah. A blind lady came up the stairs. She was a very sophisticated lady, beautiful jewelry on, but she was blind. And she was healed. And she come up almost floating. As she came up the steps, oh, look at the people. In Japanese, the interpreter was telling me that, look at the people. Oh, the people are beautiful. Look at them. Look at them. And she was healed. Well, to her ophthalmologist, because we wanted him to explain this. And after his examination, he was frustrated. He said, I can't explain it. And he said, we can't put it in the books, in the medical books, because we're only allowed to enter cases in the medical books that are the result of medication. And yours isn't the result of that. So we don't know what it is. Isn't that wonderful? You see, we tell things like that. Normal. Little boy carried there. One place, no eyeballs, no eyeball. Do you ever see anybody with no eyeballs? Yeah, and this little mother had enough faith to bring her boy. Isn't that wonderful? If I tell preachers sometime, even if you don't believe it, go ahead and preach it, the people will believe it. You know, the people will get helped. I get kind of mad at these preachers that won't tell the good news. You know, we don't need to be scared of it. They're all worried about somebody that didn't get healed. But it's funny, they don't worry about that until we come to town. When we come to town and the people start getting healed, then they get focused on somebody that didn't get healed. Well, why didn't they get it? Well, why haven't you been worried about that person a long time ago? Before, why get worried just because we came and the others got healed? See, but that's tradition. That's negativism. Love God, serve God, believe in God, read His Word, believe it's for you. You'll grow, you'll stand up tall, and you'll be happy because God loves you, God created you and designed you, and you're beautiful. Don't spoil it by being negative. See, I told the Russians, smile. And you know, we shouldn't say that to the Russians because the poor things, they went through so much. Well, you went through a lot here too. Terrible. But those 70 years of communism give you nothing to smile about. And I told them, I said, why don't you go to the market and buy yourself a little mirror and look in it? And you'll see all your lines are going downhill. And make them come up while you still got time. Make them go uphill and keep looking. Grin until you can smile, you know. And make them wrinkles go uphill where people will be happy when they look at you, not mad. You know. I heard Oral Roberts say one day, you can never preach the good news mad. You can only preach the good news glad. Now, I believe that Richard's probably said that over here. Yeah. Well, now, what am I going to talk about? I could tell you all sorts of stories. We came from, not too long ago, from Ivory Coast. Ivory Coast and Brazzaville, Congo, and Kinshasa, Congo. And the most marvelous thing, Kinshasa, a man came to the platform, beautiful man. And he was astounded. The message gave hope to people. And he confessed to the people. He was really ashamed. He confessed to the people that he had prepared poison, had it at his house, and he was going to poison his wife and two children that night. Thank God we came to town. Think about it. You know, we that bear the gospel, wherever we go, God is guiding us. And we're in harmony with His plan. And wonderful things happen. The stories that any of us could tell you are astounding. And that God is so good. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? And this dear man stood there weeping, he in shame. But I admired him. I thought, what courage it takes for a father, a husband, to stand before 50,000 or no, there's more like 100,000 there that night. It was an enormous crowd. And to stand before them, he lives among them, and to confess publicly that he was going to kill his family. But he did it. That took courage. The gospel, I guess, helped him to be willing to do that. But when he told that, I thought, how beautiful. I wonder where the family is. And I called. I asked him, where's the family? He said, I don't know. I called to the audience, and we found them. The mama and the two kids, teenagers. And they came up the platform, and I wish the world of bigots and atheists could have seen that family as they fell in each other's arms, these two beautiful teenagers. That's what we're talking about, helping people. That's what we do. Hallelujah. You believe that? Up. We came up to Ivory Coast. Three insane men were healed one night. Don't ask me how. Don't blame me for it. I didn't do it. You know. How could I do that? They were in three different areas. The crowd was over 100,000. Way out there, way out there, way out there. None of them knew the others. They were just, and evidently in the Ivory Coast, maybe they can't collect taxes and build institutions. I don't know. But they evidently, the way they treat maniacs is to put iron clamps on their wrists and chains and on their ankles. And because all three of them, from different parts had similar chains, their wrists. So evidently, that's the way they cope with insanity. And those three people, unbeknownst to me that they were even there, wasn't my faith. It was God. He loves people. Like you tonight. He's looking at you. You're weighing what I'm saying. You're wondering what I'm up to. Am I building a case to fool you or what? See. But see, I'm just talking out of my heart. God knows that. And then He sees your need. And depending on your reaction to truth, sets the limit on what He can do for you. God loves us. We're very important people. You believe that? We are the people of God. Hallelujah. And all over the world, 90 countries, I've stood before them and talked to them. I know what I'm talking about. I've been there. I've done it. What am I supposed to do? Shut up and not tell anybody about the miracles because they sound crazy? A couple of atheistic reporters met me at the airport in Stockholm, Sweden, when I went up there. You know, Sweden's got a lot of problem with atheism. They're pretty harsh about it and pretty radical and unkind about it, and kind of almost blaspheme people that believe in God. Sweden, that great missionary sending country. But these guys came out, the plane parked out on the tarmac, and they came out to meet the great miracle worker. You know, the word had gotten around, and I was coming there to preach to Alf Ekman in his big tent. And they came out to me and they said, "Well, Dr. Osborne, have you come to Stockholm to raise the dead?" Sarcasm. Sarcasm. And I stopped. I eyeballed them. I said, you've been hearing of things that's happened. Yes, don't blame me for those marvels of God. I didn't do it. Blame Him. They didn't know what to say. You know what? They went back, and in Sweden, they wrote a nice story about me. Isn't that a miracle? Sweden, to say nice things about believers and miracles? Hallelujah. Do you believe in miracles?
Yes.
Person for the kingdom of God. That's what I am. Like it or lump it, that's what I am. I come from God. Every chapter in John but 3 or 2, Jesus said, "God sent me." Read it. Check up on your Bible. Well, I decided if He thought it was important that the people that He talked to understood that He was sent from God, maybe I ought to pick up on that. So for years, everywhere I go, when I walk out on a big platform before a sea of people, I announce without apology, I say, "I've come from God. I've come with good news. I've come to express God's love to you. God sent me to you with His message of love." It's changed nations. I'm telling you, it's changed nations. When we're in a situation like that and we speak, we do speak for God. And God is with us. Now that may sound real stiff for you if you're super, superly religious. But that's what the Bible teaches us. That we as Christians are Jesus-filled people that are sent here by Him. Once we're saved and blessed and have this new life, then we have only one mission, the mission that Jesus had, the same one. And that shocks some people. Me have a mission like Jesus? No, He's holy. I'm not holy. No, no. You got it all. You got it all. misunderstood. Jesus came to show us two things. God sent him to show us God and to show us us. Wonderful. And so we look at him and we see God in action. And also we look at him and we see the pattern for our life as Christians. Do you believe that? Can you believe that? That's biblical Christianity. We've lost most of that in today. But biblical Christianity is we receive Jesus and then we share Jesus. We keep the book of Acts opens about all that Jesus began to do and teach. He began it, then he went back to heaven, sent the Holy Ghost, so all of his followers could continue to do the same thing that he did. And the book of Acts is the proof. They continued to do what Jesus did and taught. Wonderful. So I'm one of those. I'm one of those. And wherever I go, I let the people know that. And it's a wonderful mission to go to people and tell them that. And then here's what scares religious people. If you tell people that, since that's biblical, God is in the words that you tell the people. And God, that's how those three insane people got healed. They were under the influence of the Spirit of God that was manifesting itself because we were proclaiming His truth. And see, those devils couldn't stand it and they left. Now that might be strange to you, but it's not strange to us. No, no. The world over, that happens. A man, not many years ago, I'm thinking of a man. He yelled and yelled and yelled at the devil, do anything to get the attention of the people away from the Word of God. He don't want you to listen to the Word of God. And this man yelled and yelled, and I pled to the people. I said, people, he's demon possessed. Don't worry about it. Just listen to me. Just keep listening to me and ignore him. He yelled some more. And you know what he was saying? He said, you can't cast us out. We run this machine. You ever hear anybody say that? Yeah, real biblical cases. Bible hasn't changed. You're all holy and nice in a nice church, but the Bible hasn't changed. People out there, they're in trouble. They need us. They need our help. And he yelled, you can't cast us out. We run this machine. And I said, I just kept preaching, declaring the Word of God. Because I'm a farmer. I believe the Word of God is seed. And seed always has life. There's life in it. Well, Jesus said, the Word is the seed. The seed is the Word of God. Well, so I consider His Word seeds that go out to people. And I'm a farmer. I know. I grew up on a farm. 13 children. I worked hard on the farm until later when I went in the ministry. But I worked hard on the farm. And I'm from the old-fashioned days. You know, we'd hang a sack on us and with all the grain, and we'd get a handful and do it in so many steps, do it again, do it again, do it again. You know, I know all about that. And I did that. You know, we never did after we did that on a field. Never gave up on it. How about you? How many stories could you tell? You look back and think of your life, how a stubborn critter you were. And so sassy. And popping off about the gospel. Them that claim to pray and get an answer and all. You've been through it. A lot of you have been through it. Isn't that kind of disgusting to reflect on it? But you've been over that road. But Jesus sought you out and never quit seeking you. And one day, finally, he got your attention and something happened in you and you believed it. Aren't you glad it happened? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me? So the reason he committed the gospel to us, after he died, then our sins were paid for. Then he ascended to the Father. and sat down. And when he did that, he and the Father sent back the Holy Ghost. Christ came back in the form of the Holy Ghost and came and dwelt in all those that were waiting for him. It's interesting, isn't it, that the last thing Jesus said to his followers. Now, say, I'm a follower. I believe you. You're a follower. The last thing he said to people like you, they followed him out after his crucifixion, then he was raised from the dead, then he appeared to them for 40 days, talking to them about how it would be in the future. I haven't got time to go into that. That's a wonderful study. But then he led them out. And what was the last thing he said? He said, now you shall receive power. And they was all hung up on politics. They said, hey, you're going to turn the kingdom back over to us now? Are we going to rule and get rid of these Romans? Jesus said, don't worry about that. That's none of your concern. What you're concerned about is now. Now. The gospel is now. God is now. God is I am. Jesus is I am. Now salvation is real. This church is alive because of now. People that come here one way or another are going to find out the doctrine that's preached now is good now. We can have it tonight. This is our hour. You believe that? So he said, now you'll receive power when this Holy Ghost comes upon you. He's just going to leave. And you're to go into all the world and preach this. You're my witness. You'll be my witness unto the uttermost part of the earth. And he disappeared. Isn't that amazing? That would be the last words he said, not to the apostles only, to common people like you and me. He loves us. Say, he loves me. That's exciting to me. He don't quit on me. Look at good people. They were my sins were died for. I am free. I can stand before God, walk before him in peace, and someday I'll stand before him, and all these preachers scare the waddens out of you, tell you you're going to go face every word you ever said, and every bad word. No, I'm not. No. Jesus did that for me on the cross. All my sins were put on. You may have to. Come to Christ. He died for you. Your sins are removed. We don't face them. No. I wanted to get to you the picture of redemption. See, and when Christ then came back to live in us, in the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that anointed Jesus Christ is the same Spirit that anoints us, that comes into our lives. See, now that's too holy for some of you. But try to stretch. Think bigger. Think bigger. That don't mean you're supposed to run around with a halo on your head and a flimsy garment and look holy. They're starting all these conventions on prophets and all this stuff. No, stay away from it. No, I'm not interested in it. This is the book I want to follow. This is the book. I want to follow Jesus. Hallelujah. You believe that? He came, put away our sins. Therefore, he could do what he always wanted to do from the Garden of Eden when he breathed into them. His Spirit was imparted to them. Sin divided them. Jesus paid for it. Now, the Holy Spirit came back, the same Spirit, and in there when he met with his followers during this 40 days of time that he was meeting with them, he breathed on them. Isn't that interesting? And said, receive ye the Holy Ghost in John. He said, see, that same thing as the Father did when he created Adam and Eve, he breathed into them his Spirit. see. And now here's Jesus having completed all of the Father's dream so that nothing would be lost, nothing would be wasted. And so here comes Jesus, and he wants to illustrate it, so he breathes on us, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost, the same Spirit that's in me." And he went to heaven, sat down, Holy Ghost came. They all received it. Hallelujah. And here we are. Do we claim it? Do we accept it? Do we receive it? It's up to us. That don't we don't we don't have to run to the halo like us, a halo on our head. No. But we recognize who we are. Do you ever notice what Jesus said? Said in Hebrews. Said, "Lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. I come to do Thy will, O God." Isn't that beautiful? Well, that's what we come for. See, we come to continue doing His will. And you say, "Oh, but I'm not holy like you and the bishop. I can't do all them wonderful prayers like you." But Jesus loves us, and He's pleased to hand it all over to us. Said, "Now I've shown you how it works. The old deal is finished. No more altars. No more temples, no more. Never again will any man or woman, any priest, stand between us and God." No. Jesus, seated at the right hand of the Father. Hallelujah. And here we are, blessed. You believe it? You believe it? And now, that's our mission. Talk Jesus. Talk with His words. Learn nice words. Learn nice sentences to say to people. Hallelujah. You love Him? You want Him? You believe in Him? I've been thinking while I'm preaching, there might be people here that don't know Christ. Maybe you haven't been to the cross and accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. That's all there's left to do. You don't have to beg for it. We don't have to pay for it. We don't have to come screeching and hollering and begging to save us from hell. No. He did all that suffering for us. All we have, it's a gift that we receive. We accept it or we don't accept it. I'm an acceptor. Hallelujah. I like Brother Bosworth. Mm-hmm. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. I want this. This is the crowd I want to run with. They'll do me good. See? This is my crowd. You want it? You want it? I'm just wondering if there's probably some people. And you know, everyone that's not right with God can be right with God. Very simple. Very simple. Young or old. Tonight. Now. Now's the day of salvation. Now's the accepted time. You want it? Think about it. Do you want what we talk about having? You can have it. It's not just for us. It's for you. For every one of you. If you will accept the fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for your sin. Yours, whoever you are. I'm going to pray tonight for God. I'm going to help you receive the gift of God. Simple. And it's real. Hallelujah. Everybody say out loud, and you included, this isn't the prayer for your salvation. Everybody say, "Thank you, Lord, that we know the gospel." The gospel has been preached tonight. People have come forward. Because they like what they hear. Help us, Lord. We reach out to you. Look at these that have come. Bless them. Receive them. I know you will. Your heart is made glad. Thank you, Lord. Now, put your hand on your heart right here. You say, you down here, say it out loud now. Don't be ashamed. Say, "Jesus Christ, I have come forward after hearing the gospel preached. I've come to make a testimony. I believe the gospel. I believe Jesus died on the cross for me. I believe his blood was shed for the remission of my sins. I thank you, Lord. And whatever sins I've committed, I believe they're punished at the cross. Oh, thank you, Lord. I don't have to die for my sins. The wages of sin is death. But you died in my name. Thank you for it, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Now, put up your right hand. Put up one right hand. Look right up to God. Say, Jesus. Now I accept you. I'm changed. My life is being changed right now. Your power is entering my life. Hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus, for your blessing. I will follow you. Help me to be obedient. Guide me. I want to run with the Christians and believe in salvation. Now, put up your other hand, both of them. Say, I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm not lost anymore. Devil, you've lost me. Jesus has me. I'm saved. Hallelujah. Now, everybody put up both hands. Say, thank you, Lord. Say it together. Everybody. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For salvation. It's free. It's a gift. It's mine. Hallelujah. Okay, put.
Jesus bought me, and he made me a priest and king, and to keep my feet from falling, and that is why I sing.
Bring it right up, show Mum how it'll go up.
I used to be allergic to fur.
I couldn't grip at all with my fingers, couldn't even grip a pencil.
I felt all of the pain completely leave me from head to foot.
Jesus is going to take it away. Never have it again.
I was totally deaf in my right ear.
Absolutely marvellous. Thrilled to pieces. Mr. Proof.
Can be a vet now, which I've wanted to be for a long time.
But it was a marvellous sensation.
Now open. Just relax. God present. God opens blind eyes. What can you see now?
Mm-hmm.
You can see me.
Yes.
Isn't that lovely?
Hallelujah. Well, I sat up late last night. I didn't get home till almost early. Bishop Margaret Idahosa, stand to your feet. We want to salute you. We love you. We thank you for being you, the wonderful woman of God, great leader in Africa, bishop over 6,000 churches, 7 million members, plus a minister of the gospel around the world, assuming the enormous load that your wonderful husband left behind. He finished his course. Yours isn't finished. God bless you. Let's give her. We want to say some things this morning about in honor of the memory of Archbishop Benson Idahosa. But we also want to say some things that will help you. And as the Bishop Reed has said, his example will help us. Be followers, the Bible said, be followers of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Benson Idahosa inherited promises from God. So we can follow his example like we follow Paul's example, as they both follow Christ. Christ is the example. I think it's appropriate that a church like this would pause in a Sunday morning service to give honor to a man who has gone before us and who has led many hundreds of thousands of people to the cross of Christ. This is not to glorify him. This pause, this time, this service is not to glorify him as a man, but to honor the fact that he walked with God and showed us that with faith and courage, we too can walk with God and grow in God and accomplish great things for God. Right? So I'll try to read some of my notes instead of preach if I can, but I'll probably preach. But let me read some things. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. Other foundation can no man lay than that that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Ephesians 2:19 says, "Now therefore ye are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God," verse 20, "and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone." That's the main line of that copy. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom ye are builded together for an habitation of God. Hallelujah. You believe it?
Yes.
Through the Spirit. Well, I want to read a little bit of the story of Jesus with Peter. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do people say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Verse 14. They said, "Some say thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, others Jeremias, or one of the prophets." Verse 15. He saith unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" He said, that's all of them. But this guy, Peter, jumped up and gave the answer. I like him. He's always responsive. He's always, you can count on Peter. He was there. So Peter, Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Oh, I love those words, don't you? Peter must have loved them. Verse 17. Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Have you had a revelation of Jesus Christ? Yeah. Let me read a few things to honor the memory of our beloved friend, Archbishop Benson Idahosa, and his work. The International Biological Center in Britain has said that Archbishop Idahosa is among the few people who have made the greatest positive impact on the world in the 20th century. Remarkable, isn't it?
Yes.
Remarkable. Wonderful. At the age of 18 months and sickly most of the time, he was to be thrown out on the local rubbish dump and left to die. Did you know that? His mother intervened and his life was saved. Life was tough for young Benson. Many trials, many blows, many tough times. But the blows dealt to him only made him tougher. Tougher than the problems that he faced. And they served, like they always do, to shape in him character, integrity, commitment to life, and a determination to lift people so they wouldn't have to endure those kinds of blows. We can all profit by our tough times and get tougher and grow through them. He and now Bishop Margaret together founded over 6,000 churches, established Christian schools, hospitals, and medical services, and Africa's first Christian university. Marvelous achievement. At the time of his demise, over 7 million of his own countrymen looked to him as their spiritual leader and example. He represented God to Nigeria and the world. We are to do that. That's our lifestyle. We are his interpreters. People don't read the scriptures, they read us. And Benson was one of those good representatives of God, in whom God did not have to suffer limits. I want to be that way. Do you? Yes. Benson Idahosa took the good news of reconciliation with God through Christ to 149 nations, preaching to tens of millions of people face to face. A great achievement. In his and Margaret's national crusade in 1985, in their own national capital at that time, Lagos, the multitude was estimated to be over 1 million people. Tremendous. In 1967, the Idahosas founded the All Nations for Christ Bible Institute. Today, it already has 1,400 students from 28 nations. About 70% of them are there on scholarships. Classes are offered in English and in French. French students are studying from nearly a dozen French-speaking nations of Africa. One day I was talking to the Archbishop. Well, it was before he had become Archbishop. And I've known him so long and been there so often. I said to him, I said, Benson, you can't cross your border of your country any direction without going into a French-speaking country. And you don't speak French, and I don't see that you're doing anything to train people in the French world. He looked at me like only he can look at you and said, Papa, I'll do something about that. And he did. I went back the next time. There was a whole French department in the university, in the Bible school. In the Bible school. And there were French students there from many French-speaking nations. I went back last year. There were 700 French-speaking preachers and leaders there from I don't know how many nations. You remember how many were registered at that time? I don't remember, but a lot of them. Some of them interpreted for me. They didn't. I talked to them in French, didn't I? Yeah. But anyhow, it was a wonderful thing. He did something about it. Churches are being raised up all over French Africa because of their leadership.
Bible schools are being instituted all over French Africa because of their leadership. It's amazing what we can do if we love people and take what is in our hand and let God multiply it. You believe it?
Yes.
In 1968, Benson and Margarita Hossa established the Church of God Mission International as their ministry organization to train people in Christ and to build Christ's church in Nigeria. Today, there are over 6,000 churches across the length and breadth of the nation with a total of over 7 million members. That is an achievement. That's a life worth living. 1973, they began their television ministry, and today it covers virtually every state in the nation. 1975, they completed the first large church building called Miracle Center. Seats over 7,000 people in Benin City, which was very soon too small. Too small to house the thousands of people that flocked to them for spiritual leadership. In 1986, they finished their renowned and enormous Faith Arena. I had the privilege of naming that. Faith Arena. As their headquarters church, it seats just 30,000. And many occasions is overflowing and people in the streets all around it. In addition, they have raised up over, how many other churches in Benin City?
139.
In addition to the 30,000-seater, in their city, 139 other churches are raised up in the same city. I'd like to show the French that. Some of them get so fussed up if they think someone's going to come to Paris and open a new church, they're afraid they'll lose all their members. Oh no, oh no. The more churches, the more everybody gets. Wonderful. Isn't that a testimony? Benson, we're talking about you. You're terrific. Yeah, yeah, wonderful. Wonderful. The Archbishop earned numerous degrees, earned them, and has been awarded honorary doctorates by numerous institutions of higher learning. In 1989, they established what they call Faith Mediplex, a unique marriage of medicine and prayer. Today, it is a 200-bed complex with 100 staff members where 1,500 people are treated and nursed every month. It also offers outpatient services and has now opened other branches in eastern Nigeria and in the new capital of Abuja, plus sending medical mission teams into villages to minister to the medical needs of people. That's tremendous. We salute such a ministry and such leadership, don't we? It's right that we pause and make this known. It's right that in England, the people know that God has raised up such a man and such a work has happened. It's not right that we have our heads in the sand and not know what God hath wrought. The Bible is written because of the wonders of God. And again and again and again, he told his leaders, write it for a memorial. And he never wants his miracles forgotten. Yes. Right?
Amen.
Yeah. Well, that's why we're having this meeting. So that we won't forget what God did through a man who gave his all to God and became a wonderful vessel. And it tells us that there are no limits to our lives. We can look at him, or we can look at Mother Teresa, do we see? We see simple, ordinary people who took what was in their hand and gave it to God and to people. Benson had the same philosophy that Mother Teresa had. I can't see Jesus, but I can see people. I can't touch Jesus, I can touch people. I can do to people what I would do to Jesus if I could touch him and see him. He always was a people person. In 1994, they established the first Christian university on the vast continent of Africa. Christian Faith University, a good name. Yes. Yeah. It was established with accreditation from both the Benin and the Edo universities, with already an enrollment of 300 students. Yes. Wow. Yes. Wow. Wonderful. When the Archbishop went to heaven, they entombed his body near the Miracle Center. There's no name inscribed there, just a simple epitaph: Man of Faith.
Yes.
Beautiful. Beautiful. I can think of no words more appropriate to this man who has lived and ministered among us in such remarkable ways. I first knew them when he just had graduated from being a shoe salesman. Just finished. Daisy and I went to Benin City before we knew the Idahosas. We didn't know they were there. In one of our crusades in another part of Nigeria, there was a photographer with us, and we wanted to take some pictures because we wanted to illustrate the country, and we were going to produce a documentary on that crusade. That finally never did happen. We produced a documentary on the Lagos and the Ibadan Crusades. We called it Black Gold. And that picture has probably, the world will never know what that film has done to the world. It's in 67 languages. We still send them out all over the world. You can hardly find a town or village in the entire free world where one of those documentary films has not been shown. They have shown national preachers how to preach, how to make altar calls. They've shown villagers in town after town, village after village, how to pray to God. And so we were there, and so we heard that there was to be a wedding in Benin City that we could attend, and they would let us come and attend it. We couldn't take pictures of it, but we could come and attend it. Once in a while, I have gone aside and walked into sometimes primitive village life to look and to feel and to sense and to understand a little bit about the people that I'm ministering to. This was one of those occasions. This was a tough one. It was a wedding of an old guy about 50 years old, and he was marrying a little 14-year-old girl, adding her to his harem. You might wonder that we would even go to that, and you might judge us for it, but please don't. We were guests, so we had to be courteous and set and observe. It wasn't a time that we could take over and preach to them. That wouldn't have been courteous. We were treated kindly, and so we watched this ceremony, and it was really touching. When it was over, there was a big, fat witch doctor woman. She was so fat when she sat down,
She couldn't get her legs anyways near together. And that old woman, when she sat there with her legs spread out and her big old belly hanging down between them, you know, and her eyes bloody, I mean bloody, she was an old witch. And so we waited and talked to her because she could talk a little bit of English. The wedding's over, and I said, Mama, do you know about Jesus Christ, the Son of God? Ho, 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 she cut me down. She said, do you think we're pagan? That's exactly what I thought. She read my mind. Yeah. Said, we have our Bibles, we have our churches. Right over there is a church. And she was pointing to the steeple of the little Baptist church where over there. Pretty little church. It had a nice little steeple sticking up. You probably know where it is or where it used to be. And anyway, I said, Mama, do you go to that church? No. I said, do they have miracles over there at that church? She laughed. She said, miracles? No. Oh. I said, you mean if your child would get sick and you wouldn't take them over there and wouldn't they pray and they'd be healed? She bugged her eyes out and leaned over toward me. It's spooky. I mean, she looked mean. She said, white man, we're not fools. Said, that man don't believe in his Jesus like we believe in our juju. She said, if our child gets sick, we don't take him to that man. If we take him to that man, he will just thank God for the sickness. He'll say, God did it. No, we'll bring our child, and with juju, in 5 minutes, our child will get well. She said, juju. I said, do you believe in juju? And she undertook to convert me. She was after me. She said, juju is as powerful as a caterpillar tractor. Funny illustration, that's what she said. I said, Mama, someday there's a park right over there. And you're going to see lights in that park. And you're going to hear a voice. They're going to have loudspeakers. And there's going to be a white preacher over there. And it's going to be me. We didn't even know they'd host us yet. It's going to be me. I just felt good about Benin City. And I said, when I come, I said, you're going to hear me preaching. And I'm going to tell the people about Jesus and that he heals the sick and raises the dead and cleanses the lepers. And I said, they'll bring blind people and blind people will see. They'll bring deaf people, they'll hear. And they'll bring lepers and they'll get healed. I said, that will happen, Mama. I said, when that happens, what will you do? And she gave me another one of them looks, you know, when she leaned over in her big old belly hanging down there between her. And she said, white man, if you do that, we'll burn all of our juju and follow your Jesus. That's what she said to me. I'll never forget it. Time passes. We get acquainted with Margaret and Benson. They ask us to come to Benin City. We come. Benson interprets for us. We go to that big park, and the Lord only knows how many scores of thousands were there, 100,000, I don't know how many were there. It was enormous. The first night we preached, God's power was there. Mighty things happened. Miracles. And at the end, I related that story. Because I thought maybe that old woman might be there. And I said, I told about the story. And then I said, now, is there anybody here that was in that room when I was talking to that old woman? Or is that old woman here? I want you to raise your hand. You remember, Mark? Or I don't know, maybe you'd already gone home. I got a story to tell on you about that. Yeah. But anyhow,
Three, as I remember, I believe it was four people that raised their hand. They were there in that room when we talked to that old woman. And all four of them had accepted the Lord that night when they saw the miracles. So see, it was true, like that old woman said. And they were ready to leave their juju and follow Jesus. Glory to God. Well, Daisy wanted to find Margaret. She asked Benson, "Where's Margaret? Where's your wife?" He said, "She's somewhere." She'd gone home. In those days, Benson wasn't a man that was interested in women preachers. I'm telling on him. He don't mind. He didn't pay her any attention as a preacher. She sat on the back row, nothing to do. She got bored with it. Daisy knew about this. Daisy ordered her driver, said, "Take me to find Margaret." And they drove to that little house I was telling you about. You have to bend over to get in. That little house. It scared the fire out of her because she was scared. She heard Daisy was looking for her, the woman of God. And so Daisy got out of the car and hollered, "Margaret," she said, "I'm here, Mom." But kind of weak. "I'm here, Mom." They had one of their first real talks, didn't you? It was a beautiful time. Hallelujah. We love those two people. They're beautiful people. How quick Benson learned. How quick he learned that God would work as much in a woman as in a man. How quick he changed. How quick he instituted it. How quick he began to encourage women. And today, the largest Christian women's organization in the world is under Bishop Margaret's leadership. She has raised it up and nurtured it. And today, that great ministry, 22,000 women come together from 19 countries, something like 19 countries. Isn't that formidable? A true woman of God in our midst, a great leader, influencing people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. After that, we went to the, what do you call that soccer field? Oak Bay Stadium. Yeah. And we went there for a seminar. It was formidable. I'll never forget. Benson drank every word of that seminar like it was the difference in life and death to him. That man, oh, may God help us to be like him, a learner. And what he learned, he did. If it wouldn't work, he didn't want it. If it was true, put it into action. Friends, that's success. You don't know anything unless you can do it. You haven't learned anything unless you can do it. Benson was a doer. He did the work of God, an example to us. We went to their little house and bent over to go in it. We said, "This won't do. You're too important for this. You don't want people to have to bend over to get in your house. Build a bigger one." They built a bigger one. Beautiful. But they had it all fixed, all their money in it, raked and scraped and saved and scrimped to build it. And would you believe, the walls were all up beautiful, and some devil set dynamite all around it and blew that thing to smithereens, and their money was gone. The house was gone. It wasn't insured. Everything was gone. I was there, walked with them in the rubble. And I said, "Benson, build another one quick. But build it lots bigger and lots prettier." Hallelujah. Well, he sure did. Go to Nigeria and see it. What a wonderful illustration. Now, when the devil comes at you, teach that sucker a lesson. Yes. Amen. Let him know forever that when you deal with me, you'll end up getting embarrassed. Demons are personalities. They can be embarrassed. I want them to learn, wherever they bug me, they will end up getting the worst end of the deal. So they pretty much leave me alone. You can teach them. They can learn. You ever think about that? Teaching the devil a lesson? Yeah, try it sometime. We watched their minister grow. Daisy and I and our daughter LaDonna have been to their conventions many times, but the greatest honor of my life, I will say, the greatest honor of my life was accorded to me last year when Benson was conducting their leadership convention. I don't know what you call it, but it was a convention, not the regular big convention, but the convention during which Benson taught the leaders. And he always did all the preaching, morning and night. He called me. He had asked me to come several times. In recent years, I hadn't been able to get there. He asked me to come. And so I felt led to come that year. I'm so glad I did. That was my last opportunity to get to be there. But I never received such honor. This meeting is to honor him. And here I am telling about the honor he accorded me. But I'll tell you, I'll never forget it. I am so thankful I went. Not because I was honored, but I was so moved by what I saw. You need to go to Benin City, Nigeria, for your own spiritual blessing. Like I'm encouraging you, go out here to this 74 acres and stand by that big tree. You know, go to Benin City. There's nothing like it in the world. It is an experience. And you will come away. Your God will be bigger. You will think bigger. And you will dream bigger. And you'll be happier. And you'll learn joy and happiness that you may have never known before. But I went there. And he asked me to teach that convention. All of it. Morning and night. And he sat and listened. 17,000 preachers. Are you hearing me? This is awesome. And he introduced me. He said, "Papa, here are your grandchildren." Now, of course, that was very gracious of him. You know, I didn't get all puffed up about that. I didn't accept that. But anyhow, he meant that. He meant that. He said, "You taught some of us. You taught me. Now we've taught them and won them. These are your grandchildren." In a sense, you know, that was okay. But it didn't puff me up, but it awed me. It filled me with wonder at the grace of God and with joy to see that when you sow the seed keeps on growing. After you're dead and gone to heaven, the seed keeps on growing. The seed Benson has sown will go on affecting lives until Jesus comes. Yes. Absolutely, till Jesus comes. Awesome. Awesome. Four days before he went to heaven, he spent an hour on the phone with Pastor. I think 4 days, maybe 5 days or 6 days, within the last week before he went to heaven, he was on the phone for an hour with LaDonna and then was on the phone with me. And he wanted to come to Tulsa, didn't have time that time, but he was going to go back to Africa. And then we had set up together, he was going to come to Tulsa and so that we could talk about these 10 French African nations. And we were going to plan it together. And we didn't get to do it. So, Benson, we'll have to go ahead and do it without you. Yeah. But that would have been a great blessing. But Benson walked with God and was not, for God took him. I don't think he died. I think he went to heaven. Yes. It's funny, do you have to die to go to heaven? Not if God took him. You know, Enoch got, you know, we say no. Enoch, you know, we imagine because Elijah was translated, Enoch was translated. I don't say Enoch was translated. I said God took him. Him. Who's him? Him lives in the house. God took him. Now, Elijah was translated. But don't say Enoch was translated. See? Said God took him. God took him. He lifted his spirit and his head fell over and he wasn't there. I don't think Benson died. I think God took him. Lifted him. He said, I finished every vision that God called me to do. For the first time, people heard him say, I'm tired. He served communion with Coca-Cola or something. I've done that many times. You folks up here, you think you have to have juice, you'd be surprised what all you can use. You know, yeah. But anyhow, he passed around the Coke bottle and poured some with some preachers. I may not have this story just straight, but you forgive me if it's a little twisted. But the idea is there. I think it's pretty true. He passed it around and poured to, said, let's have communion. And they drank it together, and he smiled and said to them, we'll do this next in the kingdom of God. You know, repeating what Jesus said. And he sat down, and his head laid over, and he wasn't there. Amazing. He went to heaven. Don't seem like he died. Anyway, Jesus said, or the Bible says of Stephen, he was a man full of faith and power and did great wonders and miracles among the people. If the Bible was being recorded today, I have a strong idea the Holy Spirit would include Benson Idahosa as a man of God. Yeah, I believe that. I believe that. I believe that. Jesus said, upon this rock will I build my church. I will build, B-U-I-L-D, build. Excuse me, it sounds like I've got another acrostic going. I preached acrostic here. You think all my sermons are acrostics? No, it just happened this time. I had to do something. Margaret, I didn't know this was going to happen. And he told me to be ready. This is a big deal to honor a man like him. I can't do that casually. This is too important. I've been staying up late at night after I get home at midnight, sitting there and thinking, what can I do? What can I do? And so I thought of this upon this rock. I thought, that's Benson. With Christ, I'll build my church. B-U-I-L-D. And I thought, Benson was a man who was a chosen instrument of God whose life was absorbed in Christ to build his church in Africa.
Yes, amen.
Over 6,000 of them. What was his secret? Why such success? We know of no other man who has impacted the continent of Africa like this man did. Why? Let me give you five fundamentals that Benson Idahosa embraced. Five fundamentals that he embraced to build the church. And let's let B represent he believed. He believed in redemption. Benson believed in redemption. He believed he was saved. He believed he was filled with the Holy Ghost. He believed the power of God was upon him. He believed the righteousness of God was in him. He believed the life of Christ was in him. He was a believer. Build my church. Start by believing in redemption.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Go home and preach this to your people. Colossians 1:14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin. Colossians 1:20, he made peace through the blood of his cross. Matthew 26:28, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Revelation 1:5, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Benson believed in redemption. B, believe. You, Bill, B, you. Benson understood. Some folks believe things but don't understand things. Did you know that? They believe things as cliches, as dogmas, as dictums, but they don't understand anything. Benson, B, you, Benson understood God's dream. God's dream. Hallelujah. God's dream was to reproduce himself. Always. From the beginning. Benson understood that. And he produced God people. That's what the church is. Hallelujah. The eyes of your understanding, Ephesians 1:18, being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Benson understood God's dream. He was enlightened. His understanding was enlightened. He had a comprehension. He understood how God takes by the miracle that raised Jesus from the dead, puts it in a human person, and they become like God. B, you, I. He believed. He understood. He identified with his master, with the founder of the church, Jesus Christ. Other foundation can no one lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I will build my church. Benson said, yes, you can come in me and build your church. Benson, B, he believed. You, he understood. I, he identified with the Christ who builds the church. Young people, don't ever go out and try to build a church. Christ builds his church. Let him flow in you. Let him live in you. Absorb him. Embrace him as he is, not like religion has made him. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Benson could say, as Paul, excuse me, that was Hebrews 12:2. Benson could say with Paul, Colossians 1:25, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. Are you hearing that? I am a minister to fulfill the word of God in flesh today. The word of God is not something pretty to read in a book. It's to be fulfilled through his ministers in flesh. Touchable, tangible, contactable, knowable, readable, feelable. God in the flesh. Even the mystery, Colossians 1:26, even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now, glory to God, is made manifest all over Africa. It's now made manifest. Mystery, mystery, mystery. Call it a mystery. It's now made manifest. Not a mystery anymore. Glory to God. It's now made manifest. Why? Because it's in flesh and blood. We can understand that. I've been saying all week, God can't show himself in spirit. He's got to show himself in flesh. I'm yelling so loud, sounds like I'm mad about it. I'm not. I'm just excited about it. Excuse me for yelling. even the mystery which is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this ministry among the Gentiles, to among the Africans, to glory to God, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And Africans know that today. Because Benson Ida Hosa lived and preached and ministered and taught and demonstrated and manifested and illustrated and depicted and portrayed God in the flesh. And the people of Africa rose. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You believe that?
Yes.
B-U-I identified. L. His leadership was with love. That's Benson Ida Hosa. That's the Church of Jesus Christ. That's your ministry. That's your witness. Whatever you do, wherever you go, wherever you minister, lead. Lead the lost to Christ. Lead the downtrodden forward and upward. Lead the people to God, but lead them with love, not with brutality, not with judgment, not with condemnation, no, not with accusation. Lead with love. The bishop here, he gets so rough sometimes, but he's a pussycat inside. I hear his tapes. I said to Don, I said, listen to him. This is a tender, tender, compassionate gentleman. Tender as a baby. Once in a while, he spouts off. But the reason he's a leader, he leads with love. God will look over lots of our mistakes. We may be bombers in some cases. We may be not very good in some cases. But when we lead with love, nothing can resist love. Love is the only true power. God is love. Oh, he's got power, but it don't say he is power. No, no, no. What you have isn't what counts. It's what you are.
That's right.
That counts. A millionaire. We think about a millionaire. Oh, big rich man. Millionaire. Yeah. He is a millionaire. He can lose all of his money and be right at the bottom. He's still a millionaire. Watch him 6 months from now. 3 years from now. He'll have his million again. He's a millionaire. He thinks like a millionaire. He's a millionaire. It's not money. It's him. God is love. He has power, big deal. But he is love. That means the only power he has is love power. Benson led. His leadership was a leadership of love. For 2 Corinthians 5:14, for the love of Christ constrains us. John 13:34, a new commandment I give you. This is new talk. Not Old Testament talk, not Hebrew talk, Jesus talk. The carpenter from Nazareth that found God, that discovered God, that discovered himself in the scriptures. He said, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. That's the secret, as I have loved you. And he laid down his life for the sheep. Benson lived on that edge all the time, to give himself, his belongings, his life if need be, in defense of those who needed the gospel, to lift them and bless them and heal them and save them and give them life. You believe it?
Yes.
John 15:9, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. Benson continued in the love of God. Benson was rough. Benson was tough. Benson could be, he could be mean to the devil. Yeah, but Benson operated in love. That was the generating force in him. That's why he succeeded. It'll work for you. It'll work for any of us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is my commandment, John 15:12, that you love one another as I have loved you. That's what he said. Believe. He believed. You. He understood. I. He identified. L. He led with love. D. He demonstrated dignity. Build my church. Don't build a bunch of pussyfoots. A bunch of people that cower and crawl and cringe in shame. No, build and demonstrate dignity. Benson Idahosa lifted the continent of Africa to a level it's never been lifted in the history of the world. Africa has dignity. That man, as his leadership spread, and the demonstration of his life spread, and the news of it spread, lifted every African who knew about him. Africans don't crawl anymore. Hallelujah. Because a leader demonstrated dignity. Second Corinthians 4:1. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, verse 2, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every person's conscience in the sight of God. That's Benson Idahosa, his kind of leadership and his kind of life. 2 Corinthians 5:16, to all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Benson was a reconciler. We are reconcilers. We're only taking this morning to honor his memory and draw from him a fresh source of inspiration, saying, yes, God bless him. He lived. He worked hard. He went to heaven. We're still here. Our course isn't finished, but we can profit by his pattern as much as by Paul's. Isn't that right? Or Peter's, or those other wonderful people who've died in the faith, or Wigglesworth, or Dowie, or any of them. See, we're talking about a man of God. Hallelujah. And so he demonstrated human dignity. And you know what? Until we discover the dignity of a human person as a creation of God, we shouldn't be in the ministry. No. And we shouldn't even try to witness to people until we know that the lowest person is a person in the image of God. Did you ever shake a beggar in a ditch? Or did you toss him a shilling? More than once I have shaken him. I said, what are you doing down there? Hey! You stink! I don't stink! I took a bath. You didn't. That's what'll help a beggar. Not give them a coin. They'll hate you for the coin because you have and they don't. Psychologically, they'll resist you. Hey! How many hands have you got? Oh, they haven't thought that way in a long time. I don't know. I have to count. Oh, one, two. Oh, I got two. See? They don't think. Their brains are, hey, that's all I've got. Benson would do this kind of a thing. You can be sure. How many feet you got? Two. That's all I got. Hey, God paid as much for you as he paid for me. Why don't you make your life worth something? Mine's worth something. Give me your hand. Get out of the ditch. Be a human person. Listen, if we don't understand people are made in the image of God and treat them with dignity, that's treating a beggar with dignity. Give them a coin, you curse them. I don't mean not give to beggars. God bless them, give them some money. But I mean, we got to do more than that.
Yes.
Benson taught dignity to people. I'm preaching, ain't I? Okay, I'll close. I'll read a poem. I wrote a poem some time ago, and I don't know why in the world I had it stuck in my back here in my testament. There's a few things stuck back there, and I forget what they are and why they're there, but it seemed like I could accumulate things. But I thought, oh, I'm glad that's there. I want to read this poem in honor of your husband, the Archbishop, your faithful and wonderful husband, leader, interpreter of God, man of God, man of faith. And I read it to you. And when I finish, I'm going to hand the service back to the bishop. You ready for it? Christ is alive. He now reigns in our hearts. He called us. He filled us. He set us apart. God will speak to you. I have a feeling to interrupt this right now and say, God is going to call some young people through this poem right now. It's going to happen to you. Listen to the signal. I'll repeat those two lines, then I won't interrupt again. Christ is alive. He now reigns in our hearts. He called us. He filled us. He set us apart. His truth and His grace were the seeds of our start. His love energizes the life we impart. He sends us to give the good news to the poor, to tell all the captives they're prisoners no more, to announce to the blind that their sight is restored, to lift the downtrodden, they're free evermore. As the Father sent Jesus to show forth His will, now Jesus sends us to reveal Him until everyone hears that of His own free will, Christ died to redeem them and to heal every ill. So now that God's kingdom in us is the key, our reason on earth is to let Jesus be the same in our flesh. He lives to set free whoever believes the good news. Let it be. I present these notes to you, my wonderful friends. God bless you.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I have my children here with me. Fair, Ruth, Daisy, and Frida, please come. You must stand by me. First of all, I want to say a big thank you to
family, because it's family.
They're part of us, all of them. And it's a time of thanksgiving. And time of saying thank you for the gift of God within a man. Dr. Margaret's taken over a tremendous responsibility, and I know it's God's hand. She's equipped for it. She's the only person I know who could do it, and she's done it. And we want to stand with her as a people and say, the work and the seed that he planted is going to grow from generation to generation. This is his family. And we just give thanks for him. Amen. And I said when I was in Africa, when I went there, I said, what we were to the Archbishop, we will be the same. Nothing's ever changed. Nothing will change. Our commitment, our involvement, the same. Our love, the same. Because it's the way it is. They're part of us, we're part of them. And we value them. We value being part of them, we value them being part of us.
I want to thank God very much for the life of Bishop Reed and his wife and the leaders of this ministry and everyone in this ministry. Most especially for allowing them to come to be with us at the darkest hour of our lives. This is what friends are for. And I'm forever grateful to him and this congregation. It is a fact that my husband is no longer here, but we are here. And the vision continues. The vision will not die because he's no longer here. The vision will proceed and will grow more than when he was here by the grace of God. February this year, he called me and said, Margaret, everything that God has given me, I think I have finished. And I said, oh no, ask God for more, he has more. I guess you better travel. Maybe when you travel and you are back, you'll be fired up again. But little did I know that he meant what he told me. And he said, okay, when we come back from this trip in March, I'm going to rest. And I thought maybe he was going to take a vacation to somewhere and really rest. But when he came back, he really rested. And he was gone. I am grieving on the inside, but I am grieving not like the unbelievers. I have great hope. I know where he is. And I know that God is able to do what he says he will do. And one thing I'm aware of is that his will not lead us to where his grace will not sustain us. Amen. I believe in the ministry. I believe in what he has done. And if I didn't believe as much as I believe when he was with us. But with this that my dad has written and wrote and read and preached about today, I think my heart is lifted up to know that I am married to him. I say I am, even though it's not here, I am married to him. That is the man that I am married to. And I'm satisfied with that.
If not in you, I wonder where will they ever see the one who really cares? And if not from you, how will they find this one who heals the broken heart and gives sight to the blind? 'Cause you're the only Jesus some will ever see. You're the only words of life some will ever read. So let them see in you the one in whom is all they'll ever need. 'Cause you're the only Jesus some will ever see. And if not you, I wonder who will show them love, and love alone can make things new. If not from you, how will they learn? There's one who'll trade their hopelessness for joy in return. 'Cause you're the only Jesus some will ever see. And you're the only words of life some will ever read. So let them see in you the one in whom is all they'll ever need. 'Cause you're the only Jesus some will ever see. The fields are white and ready for the harvest, and the Father seeketh those who are witnesses of life. 'Cause you're the only Jesus some will ever see. And you're the only words of life some will ever read. So let them see in you the one in whom is all they'll ever need. 'Cause you're the only Jesus. 'Cause you're the only Jesus. Some will ever see.
up. Show Mum how to go up.
I used to be allergic to fur.
I couldn't grip at all with my fingers. Couldn't even grip a pencil.
I felt all of the pain completely leave me from head to foot.
Jesus is going to take it away. Never have it again.
I was totally deaf in my right ear.
Absolutely madness. Thrilled to pieces. That's the proof.
I can be a vet now, which I've wanted to be for a long time.
But it was a marvellous sensation.
Now open. Just relax. Relax. God does it. God opens blind eyes. What can you see now?
You
can see me. Isn't that lovely?
I'm going to read a compendium of scriptures tonight that comprise where we are, what we're doing, what we mean to our world. We, all of us, what we mean as a foundation for this talk tonight, the seventh indispensable principle that we need to absorb in order to carry on what Jesus began. Mark 16:15, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. John 14:13, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Matthew 28:20, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Mark 16:20. And they departed and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, confirming the word with signs following. 1 Corinthians 1:17. They preached the gospel and kept nothing and knew nothing among the people but Jesus Christ and Him crucified. John 12:32, because he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all people unto me. 2 Corinthians 2:4-5. So their message was not with enticing, with the excellency of speech, nor with enticing words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that the people's faith might not stand in the wisdom of human learning, but in the power of God. 1 Corinthians 15:1-2. And they preached the gospel of salvation by which you can be saved. 3. That Christ was condemned and mocked and crucified, that he died for our sins according to the scriptures. 4. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. And 5, that he was seen of each of the 12 whom he had sent, and of 500 believers at one time. 14, because if Christ be not risen, then, 15, is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain, and we are false witnesses of Christ. 17, and we are yet in our sins. 1:3. But he showed himself alive by many infallible proofs. 2:22. Because he was approved of God by miracles and signs and wonders that God did by him in the midst of the people. 2:3. And they preached this great salvation, 4, as they preached this great salvation, 4, God bore witness with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. 2:32. This is the Jesus whom God has raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. 2:21. And whoever shall call upon his name shall be saved. 4:12. Because there is salvation in none other, For there is no other name under heaven given among people whereby we must be saved. Romans 10:9. And if you shall believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, and if you confess with your mouth that this Jesus is Lord of your life, you shall be saved. John 1:12. And as many as receive him, to them he gives the power to become the children of God, even to them that believe on his name. John 20:31. And all the miracles that are recorded in the Gospels are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through believing you might have life through his name. 1 John 5:12. For whoever has the Son has life. John 10:10. Because he has come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly. John 1:25. Because he is the resurrection and the life. I think that reference is wrong. Anyway, you look it up and check it out. John 14:6. And no one can come to the Father but by him. John 17:3. And this is life eternal, that you might know the only true God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. John 3:15. And whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And then I can add, and this is the gospel we also preach, and this is the message of truth which he confirms with signs and miracles and wonders, so that you may believe it, receive Christ, and have eternal life today, right now. Hallelujah. Amen. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say a big amen.
Amen.
Tonight we are addressing the last letter in the word miracle, using the word miracle as an acrostic to frame seven indispensable principles that we need to embrace in order to carry on what Christ began to do and teach. Experience. E for experience. And we are focusing on the portion, all of this is found in this first sentence of the book of Acts, which I call the bridge sentence that connects the Gospels of Jesus with our gospel. What he did with what we do. How he began, how we continue. How he showed us how, and we became his imitators. That is Christianity. It is a miracle life. It is a miracle life. Hallelujah. And so we'll focus on the part of verse 4 where he said that they should not depart from Jerusalem but wait for the promise of the Father. Good advice. Experience the power. Experience the power. Now let me rehearse something to help you get a grasp on this. Let's look at that again. We talked this morning and made it clear, so I don't want to seem too repetitious, yet I want to be sure we get this. The model, the Jesus ministry, is our standard. We look at him and we know that's the way. And the reason he is the one, not Moses and not the other apostles, the other prophets, nobody else. We're not followers of anybody else. We're followers of Jesus. Because he is the person, the only person who showed us God. Never forget that. See, people, that first lesson was real heavy. You remember it. Get the tape. Study it. I wish I could have gotten all in it that I want to. But it's so important that we comprehend, we follow Jesus. That's so fickle and simple and easy to say in this generation. Because, well, everybody, Jesus is Lord. Yeah. Why is he Lord? How do you know he's Lord? What does it mean he's Lord? Oh, he's the head of the church. What does it mean that he's the head of the church? Jesus. Who's Jesus? He's a guy from Nazareth, a carpenter. Who was he? What made him different? Why follow him? It's very difficult for us religious people to dislodge our brains from our contemporary religion and look at Jesus clean and clear without the barnacles of our imagination and see him as just a new strange person that came to town talking things that nobody ever talked, doing things that nobody ever did, and he comes on the scene. The writer of Hebrews calls it at the fulfilled time, the time in history when it was ripe for him to come. What'd that mean? It meant the old system of Moses and all of that bloody, smoky, stinky, boring animal sacrifice stuff, thank God, was over. But listen, that was their religion. And anybody will kill you to defend their religion. And they killed Jesus. They killed John the Baptist. They killed Stephen. They killed all the apostles. They won't have it. They prefer their bloody sacrifices. Whatever it costs them, they won't turn loose of their works. Their works, their part to be saved. But Jesus came preaching, repent and believe the gospel. He got to change everything. And the Mosaic system was finished. Laid aside, bundled up, put away. As an allegory for us. To refer to show us that God is holy and you can't mix up sin and God. And Jesus came and teaches us that none of that is needed anymore. Now those were fighting words. No wonder they hounded Paul all over his journeys, because he brought insult upon the Mosaic religion that they had made. And Paul just kept insisting, no, you don't have to do that. And he would sit down with them and reason with them out of the scriptures. You see, Jesus came, like John the Baptist said, as the Lamb of God, and he's the offering. God has given the offering for everybody, and it'll work for anybody, Jew or Gentile. Fighting words. And none of them have to have religion anymore. Just only believe. It's too simple. You can't strip religion from its formalities or its ceremonies or no, you fight for that. But Paul said, no, that's the way it is. It's just Jesus and him crucified and risen from the dead. Believe in him and identify with him and you're saved. Nuts, they said. That won't work. That cannot work. Okay, I'm getting carried away. I won't re-preach lesson number one. The model. So Jesus is our model, and the reason we follow him, he showed us God. Moses did not show us God. No. Neither did Elijah. Neither did Jeremiah. No! They couldn't. Most folks spend their life on the I and the R. You know, being inspired and responding. It's beautiful. Hallelujah. And we write songs and we sing and we dance and we love each other and we teach classes and we're happy. Well, we got to have more than that. So then what we do, we go into action. That's the next level. If we believe it, we got to do it. You don't believe something until you do it. You haven't learned something until you do it. See? Say, I know it. Yeah. And so we go into action. Then we get out there and we with all of our joy and our happiness, and we find out that people aren't as happy as we are. And so they don't know whether we're right or not. And so they look at us and they say, what are you talking about? And we discover we got to have some dynamite. We've got to have some credibility. We've got to be able to pray and get an answer. We've got to be able to get people out of trouble. So we discover we got to have credibility. Well, hallelujah. We learn how. We find out about miracles, that Jesus is alive. His power can work through us. And so, yeah, we become credible. Glory to God. We've got that under our belt. And then, of course, we bump into some tough cases where the devil makes fun of us and said, you just think you got power. You can't make me come out. You can't. We run into what we call hard cases, tough cases. When those cases come along, we have to know where we stand in redemption. Otherwise, when we meet the hard cases, we'll say, oh, I need to get in the corner and pray through more. Oh, I need to fast 40 days. Oh, I need to call on God. Oh, I need someone to anoint me and make me more holy. Oh, I need to get more people with me. Oh, I need to have a prayer band in a hotel room bringing down strongholds. We'll do all sorts of silly things because we don't know our legality. Are you hearing me? We got to be able to look the devil square between the horns and say, Slewfoot, you're through. I'm the boss. Here's my name. I come from Jesus. He conquered you. Tell him what you know. He already knows it. Hallelujah. But then, we're all those holy people. We have that all figured out, but we don't do anything about it. None of that will do any good if you don't practice a life of ministry. You hearing me? Experience. None of it will do any good if you don't go put it to the proof. Go out in your world. You don't have to go to China. But go out in your world and practice doing what Jesus did. Experience. Now, experience will get you in trouble if you don't have the first six facts under your belt. If you don't have an image to follow, a model to follow, if you're not happy about it, I mean, there's bored Christians out there trying to talk about Jesus that, my Lord, I wouldn't listen to them. No wonder nobody else does. They're boring. They're pitiful. They're sad. They're frowning. Their fists are clenched. They're mad at the world. Boring. They don't know those other things. They haven't got any inspiration. They don't know anything about redemption. They've just memorized in the church that you're supposed to go out and tell people about Jesus. And so they talk a little bit and give a little testimony. Wonder why nothing happens. They don't have that other under them. They have never responded to redemption. They've never understood the big picture. They're dead. They're hopeless. They're chasing their tail around a stump. They're going nowhere. And credibility? Forget it. Legality? They'd run if the devil said boo. You know. Yeah. Experience. That's where we're at. We can do it. Jesus said, don't run off without this Holy Ghost. Get this Holy Ghost. Have you received the Holy Ghost? Yeah. Say, I have. See, I went to India. I had received the Holy Ghost, but I didn't know what he was for. I could talk in tongues good. Well, that's about all I knew it was for. Oh, I could prophesy. I could do several things. I could interpret. I was good at all that stuff. But I didn't know. Well, the influence that I was among gave the impression that I was in. With that, I was in. I had the real stuff because I could do those things. But I found out a lot of that's club talk. You understand what I said? I said club talk. We have cliches in our club. We have a religious club. We Pentecostals are just as bad at it as anyone else. We have a club. And we know how to talk. We know the lingo. We know the cliches to use. We have our vocabulary. We're strange to other people. They don't know what we're talking about. But we have the lingo. And so, that I was good at that. I could go into Pentecostal ranks, and I'll tell you, that's wonderful. I was considered a great evangelist. Big churches called me because I could talk it right. I had the right cliches. I had the Holy Ghost, and I could talk in tongues. But now when I got out to India, that was a different picture. They didn't know the club talk. The Hindus and the Muslims found those words strange. I decided a long time ago, I never wanted to forget how